will be great. You know, I met a lady yesterday, and I gave her our brochure, and she was like, oh, your phone number's from Montana. And I said, yeah, I grew up there. And she goes, go Grizz, I'm a proud alumni. And I was like, you really should come to church with us. Anne will love it. No, she's not here today. Well, I just met her yesterday. Maybe she had other plans. This morning, we might see her next week. Or I guess we could just go find her and get her. I do have her phone number. We could track her down, text her, where are you? That feels aggressive. I have some announcements. Okay, first announcement is about announcements. In the back, you will notice that we will have this fine clipboard. This doesn't matter so much now, but it might be important to you come September and August. So if you have any announcements throughout the summer that need to be made, write them on this clipboard. And someone will make them while I'm on sabbatical. Won't that be nice? So clipboard will be in the back. And if you have an announcement to add, look, see, I already added one because I forgot about it. And so I didn't type it up, I had to add it in, see? So, easy peasy, that's the announcement sheet. We're gonna be using it all of June so we can all practice. Okay, cool. Oh, I need my announcement sheet to read the rest of them. Craft group meets on Wednesday from 9 to noon. Everyone is welcome. Next Saturday and Sunday, June 9th and 10th, is our two-day sewing camp. If you didn't sign up but want to, talk Friday and Saturday. What did I say? Oh, I wrote Friday and Saturday. But it is Friday and Saturday. I'm on Sunday time. Friday and Saturday, June 9th and 10th, is our two-day sewing camp. If you didn't sign up but would like to, please let me or Sherry know, preferably before Wednesday. Today would be the best, but before Wednesday is good. Please bring any used books, puzzles, or games this week or next, and they can be dropped off in the old nursery room or the teen room or the room with the ping pong table, however you call that room. It's right over there, and that's where the books can go. The Secret Sister Reveal has been moved to June 13th at 6 p.m., It will be a potluck. If you have questions or concerns, please contact Linda Deasing. Here. It will be here. Yes. Thank you. Our used books, puzzle, and game sale set up, when we're going to sort and set and make everything ready to go, will be June 13th, 14th, and or 15th from 1 to 3. And we'll need a lot of help and hands, so if you can come to any or all of those days, that would be great. The sale itself is Friday and Saturday, see how I did that this time, June 16th and 17th from 10 to 2. If you can help, please talk to Sandy, and please invite your friends to come and shop with us. Our next band book club will be The Bluest Eye by Toni Morrison, and that will be discussed on June 18th at 7 p.m. We're almost done. Okay. We are looking for people, volunteers, church members, church friends, to lead tours of our church building this summer. We're going to offer tours to the visitors who are here for the Forest Festival on July 1st and on Monday, July 3rd, from 12 to 3 each day. John's going to put together a script, so you don't even need to know things. You can just read the script. And if you would like to volunteer or have time to volunteer for a day or part of a day, please contact John, and he'll get you signed up to do that. It's a great opportunity to let people who've never been in here come in and see our building. So, okay, where did it go? Ha! If you colored in your fruit of the Spirit and you brought it back with you, you can bring it to me and we'll get it up on the wall. And this is not mine, but it's a beautiful example. So those, you can just plop those in the offering plate if you want, if you brought it. And if you didn't, that's okay. We'll forgive you. All right, we're going to light our candles as a reminder that God's light shines in even the darkest of corners. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for music, for worship with the music of the prelude. Please rise if you are able and join with me in the call to worship. In the name of the Creator, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
In the beginning was the Word,
and the Word was with God,
and the Word was God.
In the beginning, the Spirit of God swept over the face of the waters.
In the beginning,
God said, "Let us make humankind in our image." And so we came into being, created by God who exists in community. We are here as God's community to worship the source of our being. Our first hymn is "Holy, Holy, Holy, Lord God Almighty," which is number 10.
Thank you.
Friends, please be seated. Let us join together in a prayer of confession. Holy God, we were created in your image, an image of mutuality and respect for one another, an image of a dance ever moving, ever in tune with one with others, an image of community with shared blessing and mission. You have given us dominion over the work of your hands. You have charged us to be fruitful and multiply, to make disciples of all nations. Forgive us, God. We have denied our purpose. We have abused the earth's resources for our own selfish gain, and the consequences wreak havoc upon the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and every living thing that moves upon the earth. Forgive us, God. We have defiled your image. We have regarded some of your children as other, and therefore beyond the reach of your love and care, because their professed faith in you, or lack thereof, is different from our own. Forgive us, God, for we have sinned. Family of faith, know this. God desires to see broken relationships restored and has heard our prayer. In the name of Jesus the Christ and in the power of the Holy Spirit, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Let us greet one another, those who are worshiping with us in this place and those who are worshiping at home, with the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you. Okay, so if the young people want to come up, you can, but you don't have to. It's okay. So, you going to come up or you going to stay there? Yes! I like it when I'm not alone up here in the front. I mean, the choir is great, but Mary can be sassy. Good morning! Carl, that is a nice outfit. You look good. So, do you guys know of anything in the world that you know is true, but you don't understand how it works? Yeah? Like what?
Ice cream.
You don't understand how ice cream is true, and you don't understand how it's made. I am grateful that ice cream is true, though. Right, we have dinosaurs, but we don't really know much about them because we weren't alive when they were alive. That's true. Sylvia, you have one? How God and Jesus made the world. We know it's true because we're on it, we hope. But we don't know exactly how it happened. That's a good segue into where I'm going.
How is God Jesus?
That's an even better segue. Wow, Carl. You were. I didn't coach them ahead of time. So today is a day that we call Trinity Sunday in the church calendar. Have you ever heard the word Trinity? No. Sylvia, you've heard it. Do you know what it is?
Yeah, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
The Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Perfect. Do you know how to explain that? It's okay, me either. So we call it the Trinity, and it's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and we say that they are three in one, because we only believe in one God, but we understand that God has multiple parts, like God, the Creator who made the world, and Jesus, who, we know who Jesus is, right? Yeah, Jesus, who came and lived and taught us how to be, and then the Holy Spirit who came on Pentecost, which was last Sunday when all of the disciples ran around their town speaking in tongues, telling everyone all about Jesus in words that they could understand. It's pretty cool, right? But how do we understand that there's three persons in one person, right? That's complicated. I don't get it either. I feel like they're figuring out. So some people say, let's ponder that one for later. So some people think of the Holy Spirit and God and Jesus as like trees, because there's the roots of the tree, and then there's the trunk of the tree, and then there's the leaves of the tree, and that's close, but not quite. And some people talk about the Holy Spirit and God in water, because water can be liquid, like when we drink it, right? Can water be solid, like when it's ice? And can water be like air? Exactly. So they're all water, but they're a little different. But that's not quite right either. So this is one of those things, much like ice cream and dinosaurs, that we kind of just have to know is true, even if we can't really understand it. And we can't understand it because God is just really big, and we're just people, and we're just doing our very best, right? I hate not knowing, though, don't you? Me too. But what can we do? We can just keep, what can we do to help learning and keep trying to figure it out?
Go to school.
Go to school. Go to church. Read the Bible. Eat ice cream. I get my best solutions while I eat ice cream. That is a truth. You people just get me. We can pray. We can talk about it together, because I might have an idea, and that might help you think of an idea, and then we talk about our ideas together, and we see what we can learn from one another. I call that fellowship hour. It's my favorite. So lots and lots of ways that we can explore further. So are you as confused as me? Yeah, I know. We're never going to solve the Trinity, but we can keep talking about it. I might find bones of sharks and octopuses and fish in the ocean. That is true. I don't know why I want to go look for them.
In my neighborhood,
maybe. Let's come back to that one, too, and let's say a prayer together. Loving and gracious God, we love that you are with us, and we give you gratitude for all of the ways you show up as the Creator, as Jesus who teaches and guides us, and as the Holy Spirit that moves us along. We may not fully understand you, but we are grateful for the opportunity to journey with you and to grow within you. Amen. All right, next week we'll solve another problem. That'll be good. Are you gonna stay there? You could go sit down again, or go play, or do whatever you do, or hang out there.
I am hopeful. Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow me, I will bring you home. I love you and you are mine. I am strength for all the despairing. Healing for the ones who dwell in shame. All the blind will see, the lame will all run free, and all will know my name. Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you. Come and follow me, I will bring you home. I love you and you are mine. I am the word that leads you to freedom. I am the peace the world cannot give. I will call your name, embracing all your pain. Stand up now and walk and live. Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by name. And follow me, I will bring you home. I love you and you are
I forgot the camera isn't that big, so I'm going to come down here by you.
Everything was dark when God began creation. God's Spirit swept over the waters of this yet-to-be-shaped planet.
Let there be light, God commanded, and there was light. Beautiful light flooding over part of the planet as it began to spin on its axis.
That was the first day, the light that illumines all.
God called the light day and the darkness night.
God looked at the waters and separated them.
The waters above were called sky. The waters beneath called oceans, seas, rivers, lakes, ponds, and streams.
So the second day was accomplished, and God was pleased.
God was pleased, but God wasn't done yet. Pushing up from the waters came the dry land.
Springing forth from this land were fruit, trees, and vegetation.
Each fruit and plant yielded seed, each according to its kind, so that it would reproduce and continue.
Delighted with God's work, his own work, God declared it very good.
And so the third day occurred, lush and green, beautiful and with golden grain, and the earth was giving birth to those things which could sustain life.
God scattered lights in the sky and called them stars to illuminate the night. A greater light was placed in the sky in the day, and it was called the sun. A lesser light was given in the night sky, and God called it moon.
God was very pleased and saw that it was very good. That was the fourth day.
The beautiful waters of the seas and oceans were vacant, and so God created the wondrous sea creatures, fish, and all manner of sea and ocean creatures.
The lakes and rivers teemed with fish and aquatic life.
God saw that it was good, and so the fifth day was accomplished.
We need some creatures to roam the earth. God created all the creatures upon the earth. Endless was the variety of wildlife God created.
We need someone to take care of these creatures.
So God created humanity, and the writers of Genesis wanted us to remember that we are created in God's image, not to be God, but to be God's good stewards, the people who would treat the earth carefully and lovingly.
So that's how they saw it, the beginnings of our ministries of peace with justice, beginning as stewards of God's creation, not abusers, not destroyers.
We perhaps haven't done a very good job. We've abused land and people. We have enslaved people, allowed young ones to starve, old ones to give up hope. That is not how God wanted it.
We've got another chance to do this right, right now, this very minute. It's up to us. We who call ourselves by Christ's name must now bear some responsibility for this earth and its people.
Then God will see creation, its creatures, its human, and call it very good. I was going to preach this Sunday on the Trinity, but then I remembered that I don't understand the Trinity without committing several sins according to the treaties that the ancient saints set up for us, because you can't do it. It's modalism. It's really hard. So then I thought, I'll preach on the creation story. And then I wondered, how many of us spend any significant amount of time with this story? I can promise you it's not something I jump at the opportunity to preach on. I get frustrated with it. It's one of those stories that can cause some of us to feel kind of uncomfortable. Because are we supposed to take it literally? Why are there two stories in the Bible that all about creation, but don't say the exact same thing? And if we're supposed to take it literally, which one is true and which one is wrong? And if we don't take it literally, how are we supposed to interpret it? What do we do with it? We who have come to understand a lot about how the earth came to be, how plants and animals and humans came to be, it doesn't make sense that God would have done that in 6 days. It challenges us in ways that we don't know how to talk about always. And when I try to answer all the questions that I find when I read this scripture, I find I get more questions than answers, because I get one answer that leads to two or three more questions, and pretty soon I have too many questions, not enough answers, and I don't know what I'm going to do next. But I think that's part of the problem. I'm spending too much time trying to answer questions that don't need answers. Perhaps you are like me and you get a little bit lost in trying to figure out all the details. You want to make sure you have all your ducks in a row before you start looking at the important things, and you miss the big picture. So what in this story might be the big picture? What's the things that we need to be reminded of? At least 7 times in the scripture, if we read it from the Bible itself, is we would hear God say, and God saw. I guess we wouldn't hear God say it, but we would hear that God saw. What I hear from that is that we were created by a God who sees. God takes time to watch and observe and takes us all in. God sees this world, the good and the bad, the pretty and the ugly. And God sees you. When the world feels big and you wonder if you matter, if you make any difference, and if you are seen at all, remember that the first words that we have about God is a reminder that God sees. God sees all of creation. God sees you. You are seen by God. You matter. The creation story also tells us that when God took a step back to see the world and to see what God was creating, God saw that it was good. God saw that the world was good. Before anything else happened on earth, the world and what was in it was good. We don't hear that God separated the good from the bad and banished the bad. We don't hear that God created good things and bad things. We hear that God separated land from water, air from earth, night from day, light from dark. We hear that God created animals and plants, including people, and we hear that all of it, every single part of it, was good. Or in some cases, very good. That isn't to say that bad things haven't found their way into the world. That isn't to deny that very wicked and sometimes evil things happen, probably daily. But what would it mean if every day we woke up and remembered that the world's default setting, that our default setting, was goodness? What if we looked at one another and tried to see in us our capacity for good rather than anything else? When God created the world, God created it full of goodness. So what if we spent our days believing in our own power to bring more goodness into the world? What would it look like if we leaned into what it means to be beings created to be good and to bring more goodness every day? When God created you, God created something good. The creation story also tells us that our God is a God who makes things new. It tells us that God created all that we know on earth from nothing in only 6 short days. Whether or not we believe that doesn't matter. But it doesn't stop there. God is still making things new. You cannot step into the same river twice. No two sunsets or sunrises look the same. We are given a new day every 24 hours. Theologian and writer Frederick Buchner says this: using the same old materials of earth, air, fire, and water, every 24 hours, God creates something new out of them. If you think you're seeing the same show all over again 7 times a week, you're crazy. Every morning, you wake up to something that is entire in all eternity, never was before, and never will be again. And the you that wakes up was never the same before and will never be the same again. So with each new day, the only question that we should be considering is, what good thing can you and God create next? God hasn't stopped creating new things. God hasn't stopped working to bring more and more goodness into the world, so perhaps we shouldn't either. I found a few more important things that I probably should remind you about in the creation story, such as a God who knows when to stop working and take a well-deserved rest. But I'm not going to list them because we have a lot of church left to do this morning. And instead, I'm going to give you homework. I'm going to invite you to take some time and read over the creation story. Any version of the Bible you like. It's Genesis 1 through chapter 2, verse 4. And see what you find for yourself. What truth will you see hidden in these verses? What good thing is waiting for you to discover? How will these ancient words be made new for you? Amen. Our next hymn is hymn number 1, because we're starting at the beginning today. seated. God has abundantly bestowed gifts of generosity upon us. Let us give now to the wider world, our church and our community. Jerry. We were going to take the offering. Let us join together in the prayer of dedication. Receive these gifts, even our very lives, for your service. Multiply them and our effort to meet the need. We are yours, God. Use us, as we pray. Amen. While you take your seats, I'm going to invite those who wish to affirm their baptism by uniting with us in this household of faith to come up here. You can be wherever you like. Right here is good. They're going to be over there. Actually, you should use that microphone, John. We're just going to make it friendly, and we're going to make it awkward, because why not? How we look over there on camera. Beautiful. Friends in Christ, we are all received into the church through the sacrament of baptism. These people, our friends, have found nurture and support in the midst of this family of Christ. Through prayer and study, they have been led by the Holy Spirit to affirm their baptism and claim their presence, in our presence, their covenantal relationship with Christ and the members of this church. They are here for service to Jesus Christ, using the gifts which the Holy Spirit bestows. You are no longer strangers and sojourners, but you are equally citizens with the saints and members of the household that God built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus alone being the cornerstone in whom the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in Christ, in whom you are also built into it for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. Do you desire to affirm your baptism into the faith and family of Jesus Christ? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Beautiful. Do you profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior?
I do.
Do you promise by the grace of God to be Christ's disciple, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the word and work of Jesus Christ as best you are able? If so, say, I promise with the help of God.
I promise with the help of God.
Perfect.
Do you promise, according to the grace given you, to grow in the Christian faith and to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ, celebrating Christ's presence and furthering Christ's mission throughout the world?
Today we rejoice in your pilgrimage of faith which has brought you to this time and place, and we give thanks for every community of faith that has been your spiritual home, and we celebrate your presence with us.
Do you promise to participate in the life and mission of this family of God's people, sharing regularly in the worship of God and enlisting the work of this local church as it serves this community and the world?
I promise with the help of God.
Okay, so this is where you all come in. If you haven't gotten your inserts out yet, we'll need those. Let us unite with the church in all times and places and confess our faith in the triune God together as we accept new members of our church community. Do you believe in God?
I believe in God.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit.
Let us, as we represent the members of Manistee First Congregational Church, United Church of Christ, express our welcome and affirm our mutual ministry in Christ.
We welcome you with a joy in the common life of this church. We promise you our friendship and prayers, and we share the hopes and labors of the Church of Jesus Christ. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we continue to grow together in God's knowledge and love and be witnesses of our risen Savior. In the name of Jesus Christ and on behalf of the Manistee First Congregational Church, United Church of Christ, we extend to you the hand of Christian love, welcoming you into the company of this local church.
Nope. And you also get some things out of the swag bag. We have plates and Christmas ornaments and pillows and note cards and shingles off the roof and lime green bags. We decorated the shingles off the roof with a photo of the building.
That's kind of cool.
It is kind of cool. Yeah. You know you want it.
This pillow looks
good. Yeah. Oh, we got a taker for the pillows. Good choice, Carl.
Does it match one of the windows in here?
It does match one of the windows. It is, I'm going to bet that one, the cross window. All right. Everybody got some swag. Excellent. We're going to pray first. And then we all have to clap for you because we like to make it awkward. Let us pray. Oh God, we praise you for calling us to faith and for gathering us into the church, the body of Christ. We thank you for your people gathered in this local church and rejoice that you have increased our community of faith. Together, may we live in the Spirit, building one another up in love, sharing in the life and worship of the church, and serving the world for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Welcome. See? Curtsy. One of my mentors when I was a kid at church camp would begin every communion service with the same invitation. He would point out that each time we gather around the bread and the cup, that there are three things every person needs to hear as often as possible. Welcome home. Dinner is ready. I love you. Here we are at God's table. The places have been set. The bread and the cup are ready, and God is waiting. No matter if this is your first time or if you are here every Sunday, this meal and this table is for you. God is waiting. So come just as you are, and know that you have a home here and that you are welcome. So welcome home. Dinner is ready, and you are loved. God is with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to the Holy One, our God.
It is good and beautiful to give God our praise.
Eternal God, we thank you for the universe that you create. We thank you for your presence in our lives. We thank you for the gift of salvation. We thank you for your will for justice and your liberation for the oppressed. We thank you for the gift of Jesus. Holy mystery of love, with all creation, we sing your praise. Blessed are all who come in your name, and blessed is Jesus, Word made flesh, love made real. Conceived and led by your Spirit, he taught and healed, fed the hungry, honored the outcast. Infinite love in mortal form, he was crucified. But alive with the Holy Spirit, he was raised. He comes among us to renew your covenant, to be with us always in love. So pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and cup, that they may be for us the body of Christ. Pour out your Spirit on us, that we may be for the world the body of Christ. One in your grace, radiant with love and empowered by the Holy Spirit, for the sake of healing the world. Mother and Father, Son and Spirit, we thank you and we bless you. On the night of his arrest, Jesus gathered once more with his friends and followers, and after they had finished eating their supper, he took the bread and he broke it, saying, "This is my body, which will be broken for you." And after that, he took the cup and he blessed it, pouring it out, passing it around to those at the table, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, poured for you. Let us remember this as we pass the bread and the cup around." Our bread is gluten-free. We have white wine and red grape juice. If you prefer pre-packed communion packages, they are in the wine tray. Please eat the bread as soon as you receive it, and we will hold the wine and drink together. hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please rise for our final hymn, number 325. As God's word was sent into the world to heal and redeem, so God sends you into the world this day to be light and love, healing and hope. Go now and be the light for the world. And may the grace and peace of God the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer come upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen.